Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup again, and welcome to station number 19, where we are looking at some of the muscles associated with the neck. And you can't talk about neck musculature without talking about arguably the most dominant muscle in this area, and that is the sternocleidomastoid muscle. As you can see on this particular image that is a straight anterior image, you can see that it is going to form this fairly large region on the lateral sides of the neck. And it is these other muscles that we'll talk about, the supra and infrahyoid muscles, that will be more in the midline and will be a little bit deeper than those structures there. But sternocleidomastoid is forming these very rope-like dominant muscles a bit more superficially, and you can really see it quite well on this kind of anterolateral image of the sternocleidomastoid. And it's going to have its superior attachments way up here towards the ear, so that mastoid process, and a little bit on the occipital bone. And then it will have its more inferior attachments on the manubrium of the sternum, which you can't quite see here, but you can see the tendon extending there, and as well as the clavicle. Thus, the sterno, meaning sternum, clido, meaning clavicle, and then, of course, that mastoid up here in the superior attachment. So very dominant in this region. You can see the external jugular vein is always going to run over this particular muscle. That's something that can be visible through the skin. And it is going to be superficial to the carotid sheath, which is a really important neurovascular bundle when you talk about some of those structures when you're in the vascular part of the course. And again, it is going to be more lateral and superficial to those suprahyoid muscles and infrahyoid muscles. Okay, moving quite deep in terms of the neck. So the sternocleidomastoid has been reflected. You can see it all the way up here in this image. You will have one muscle, again, that is quite deep. It is going to have its distal attachment on the first rib, which has been cut here. You can see a little bit of the lung right here. So we are quite deep in this region. And this is going to be something you'll learn later, but the arch of the aorta that is going to give off some of the larger structures associated with the neck and the root of the neck to head to the upper limb. And we're focused mainly on this artery right here, the subclavian artery. It will change its name around this region here into the axillary. But the reason that I wanted to point this out is because the anterior scalene, which is this muscle here that I'm outlining, the anterior scalene is going to subdivide the subclavian artery into three parts based on its relationship with the anterior scalene. So if this portion right here that is medial to the anterior scalene would be the first part. The second part would be deep to the anterior scalene, so we can't see it here because the anterior scalene hasn't been reflected. And then the third part would be lateral to the anterior scalene, or distal to. And then once again, once it passes this first rib region, the name changes to the axillary artery. This is going to play a supplementary role in terms of respiration as well, but a lot of times when you hear about anterior scalene, you mainly hear about it in its relationship with the subclavian artery. But also there's going to be a nerve right here that sits right on top or superficial to the anterior scalene, which is the phrenic nerve that's important in terms of innervating the diaphragm. So more about its anatomical relationships and less about its function in terms of contraction. And lastly, you can't talk about the muscles of the neck without talking about the supra and the infrahyoid muscles. There are going to be four of each. But I'm not going to have you identify any of the specific ones, but I do want you to have a basic understanding of where they are located and their basic functions. For me, when I'm trying to identify these, I always try to find the hyoid bone, which is a little bit difficult to see, but is right here. This will be the hyoid. So any of the muscles that are superior to that would be part of the suprahyoid muscles. And then any muscles that are inferior to that and still towards the midline region would be part of the infrahyoid muscles. So you can see them right over in these regions. These suprahyoid muscles are going to play a role in terms of supporting the hyoid, as are the infrahyoid muscles. But the suprahyoid muscles, when they contract, can play a role in terms of elevation of the hyoid. You can see that it's also forming kind of the floor of the mouth. Whereas these infrahyoid muscles are a bit longer, they're a bit strap-like. That's why you often hear these muscles referred to as the strap muscles instead of the infrahyoid muscles. And they can play a role in terms of depressing the hyoid or moving it inferiorly. And some of these will actually have a connection to the thyroid cartilage, which is part of the larynx. So if we were to flex some of these infrahyoid muscles, you could see the larynx and you could see the thyroid gland. So there's a lot more structures associated with under or deep to the infrahyoid muscles. Okay, excellent. So those are the muscles of the neck. Some are quite large and obvious, like the sternocleidomastoids, which you can see here that are reflected. Oftentimes you have to reflect this to be able to see any of those deeper structures. We have the anterior scalene, which is quite deep. You would have to be at the level of the subclavian artery to really see that. And then, of course, the supra and infrahyoids, supra above the hyoid, infra below the hyoid, and mostly in the midline region. All right, excellent. Thanks for your time and attention here, and let us move on to the next station.